You're listening to The Money Hour with your host, Tina Mitchell. Sponsored by Absolute Mortgage, a division of Pinnacle Capital Mortgage Corporation. Now, in the studio, local mortgage and finance expert, Tina Mitchell.
Welcome back to The Money Hour with your host and mortgage expert, Tina Mitchell, right here on 1150 AM KKNW, the Saturday, January 16th show. I am dedicated to my listeners, providing you with tools needed to make informed decisions on matters that affect your money. If you're hearing my show at a different time or day, you are listening to a rebroadcast, but you can call the show at 1-855-400-1150. Again, that's 1-855-400-1150 or online at themoneyhour.com if you'd like to connect with any of the experts that I have in studio today. And we're going to have a conversation regarding real estate, everything regarding real estate with the best in the industry. Again, I have Lori Way with Coldwell Banker Bain, Jennifer Nielsen with Real Living Northwest, Jeff Dickinson with REMAX on the Lake, and Katie Frazier with Trident Realty Group Northwest. I'm so excited, you guys, to have you in studio. It's really rare that I have a panel conversation, so I know it's special for the listeners. Thanks, you guys, for coming in.
Thanks for having us.
And a little background about each one of them. I want to go ahead and start out with Lori. Lori, again, is with Coldwell Banker Bain. In her 20th year of real estate in the greater Puget Sound area, assistant principal manager broker for Coldwell Banker Bain, Lake Union office, and is a previews international property specialist. Lori has been awarded President Circle Award for being in the top 2% of Coldwell Banker Bain agents internationally. She loves to work with first-time home buyers as well as market luxury waterfront homes. Also, I have Jennifer Nielsen with Real Living Northwest Realtors. Jennifer was at the top producing agent for EQ Real Estate from 2003-2005 and moved into tech real estate and homes in 2006. Jennifer made the move over to Real Living Northwest Realtors, a national franchise that is recognized by the National Association of Realtors as the fastest growing real estate company in the U.S. in 2011. Jennifer has peer nominated for NAR Magazine 2006 30 Under 30. Features is a member of SCAR, NAR, WAR, and sat on the 2000 board of Seattle Young Professionals Network. She is also a designated certified negotiation expert and taught as an instructor for the Washington State Housing Finance Commission. In 2010, Jennifer earned her Green Broker designation through NAR and earned her Earth Advantage Broker designation. Jeff Dickinson, REMAX on the Lake. Over the years, Jeff has been involved in development of apartments, office buildings, residential condominiums, and self-storage facilities. His real estate practice includes extensive buyer and seller representation of residential properties throughout the Puget Sound region. Jeff is also the founder of director of REMAX Home Advantage Program, one of the most successful real estate teams. The primary focus is corporate employee representation with over 90 corporate clients, including Boeing, UW, King County, City of Seattle, Harborview Medical Center, and has been in the best of the best to get into corporations like this. You have to be the best of the best to accomplish that. And last but surely not least, I have Katie Frazier, Trident Realty Group Northwest. Almost 2 years in the real estate, so she's the newest in the industry that I have on panel. But Katie works primarily with VA buyers. Katie, thank you for all that you're doing for our veterans, mainly who are active duty and PCS to the Northwest, purchasing their home sight unseen. Katie has the opportunity to film 3 episodes of HGTV Island Life on Vashon Island this past year, and obviously for that has to be a true expert. So time in the industry doesn't necessarily mean everything all the time. So I'm really excited, you guys, to have the panel conversation, and we'll just see who wants to answer the questions here and start out with my first question. What stats can you guys provide to my listeners from 2015? So what are some things that you can share? Lori?
So one of the things that I think is really important whenever you're listening to facts and figures of anybody is see what the geographical area is. Everything is so micro neighborhoods right now. One neighborhood could be completely different than the other. One of the areas that I work in is Queen Anne and Magnolia, and a very hot area in downtown. And last year over this year, so 2014 over 2015, Queen Anne Magnolia was up 10.2% in their median pricing.
Wow.
And then King County, just to show you the difference, King County was up 13.1%.
Okay.
So I try to tell people it's about right now trending about a half a point a month.
Okay, great. Yeah. Anybody else on the panel want to share some stats?
I heard something interesting, and maybe you
Ms.
heard it.
Jen?
Maybe you heard it too, Tina and Lori, when you were at the meeting this week. But Windermere's chief economist, Matthew Gardner, spoke to us, and one of the things that just was so profound that he said was that we are now experiencing the lowest inventory in Seattle, King County since 1992. And if you are a buyer listening out there, that probably is ringing very true with you. But I knew it was bad. But when he said that statistic, it was a real eye-opener.
Yeah, you know, it was for me too, Jen. When I heard that, I thought, oh my gosh, that is just crazy. And we, for my listeners out there, you might have remember hearing Matthew. He was in last week in studio. And yeah, what a wealth of information that he brings to our area. Jeff or Katie, any stats that you got going on in your, what you're seeing?
Well, I think to segue a little bit with that low inventory stat is I think the lack of inventory is actually skewing the statistics that we're seeing. December, for instance, it was 10% lower than a year ago.
Okay, yeah.
Because there's nothing to sell.
Yeah.
So,
good point.
You know, we've got 500% buyers and 1% inventory.
Yes, it's crazy. Katie, I just want to do a shout out over there because I know you're in a totally different market than my other guest in panel because you work the South End, and that's why you have the privilege to work with so many of our veterans out there. What have you experienced in comparison to what you what you're hearing in our market here?
Right. Well, I pulled some stats this morning, and I looked at the current active single family homes that are active right now are 2,005. And so at the top of the market in 2008, or at the high water mark, there was 7,700.
Wow.
So we're down 300%.
Oh my gosh.
That gives us 2.25 months of inventory right now in Pierce County. So we're
Does anybody know what the average, what is the good market on the inventory, Lori?
What is the good market?
What is a good market for the actual, what do we call it?
Like a balance.
The balance, yes.
About 5 months.
Yeah,
about
five, six months.
Okay.
Yeah, that's correct. So right now, King County is at 1.25. So we're like right there with you guys, just a little bit more.
And is that new, Katie, that because with your guys' market that you're actually seeing such a low inventory as well? It's kind of a little bit new, right?
It's a little bit new.
Yeah.
Just in the last 6 months, we're in multiple offer situations.
Yeah.
It's getting a little bit crazy down south as it is. It's been up here.
I know. It's just funny because, you know, time, you know, there was a time where we just, you know, wanted to be able to have a little bit lower inventory, and now it's the exact opposite.
Yeah, that wasn't that long ago either.
It wasn't. I know. It's just crazy. What's happening in the local real estate market right now? As far as I mean, we've already talked about the lack of inventory is happening. Do you guys see any improvement coming up, or what other challenges are we having right now in the real estate market, Jeff?
Well, I don't think that inventory can get much lower. So
that's a good point.
I'm
it can't get any worse.
I'm kind of optimistic that things are going up. You know, speaking for myself, I've got 8 new listings coming up in the next 2 weeks, which is kind of unusual for me. So I'm hoping that's a more broader indication of the market.
Because you work with a lot of buyers.
I do.
Yes.
I do. So I'm hoping that that's a sign of things to come, that we've got to bottom out somewhere and then come back up.
Exactly. So we've had a lot of great, you know, great market this year. Do you guys see it slowing down for the next year? I don't want you to have to quote any percentages, but an idea of what you think for our next 12 months that we might be able to see as far as appreciation. What do you guys think?
Well, Tina, I think for appreciation, I don't know about everybody else, but I don't want those huge numbers. That just makes it such a willy-wacky market that it's not a win-win situation for anybody.
I agree.
So what I would like to see, and I think what we're going to see, is just very careful increases. I think that it's not going to be these big swoops. I hope not, knock on wood. But I think we're going to continue to just see slow. The biggest problem right now in the market is people want to sell their houses, but they don't have anywhere to buy buy.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So they're all scared. Nobody wants to put their house on the market and then be homeless.
Exactly.
And so that's the biggest struggle, is we've got to try to figure out and advise them as realtors, what are some of their options to be able to help that situation.
Makes sense. Yep. So in the low inventory being of our biggest challenge, what about 2016 with new construction? Do you guys, what are your thoughts with any of that helping out our market? Jeff?
I think the biggest challenge with new construction is every builder is building to $500,000 to $1 million levels. So where's that $300,000, $400,000 homeowner? What can they do? That's the biggest challenge that I see out there.
Jen?
Yeah, you know, we've seen an increase in resale at about 6.5%. But I think in King County, the statistic was something like new construction was up 16% this year. I mean, there's such a demand for it. I think people were so hungry after the recession. No one was building. There was no money being lent. And now it's slowly coming back, and they want that shiny new penny, and they're just so hungry for it. And quite frankly, new construction is an easier home to buy. There's no seller that has to sell. They don't have to find a new place to go. All they have to do is sell, which is fairly easy right now, and they can move into their brand new home.
Best solution.
Yeah.
One of the problems with that, Tina, is though that we are in a very waterlogged area.
Okay.
And there's not a lot of places for new construction.
Yeah.
I mean, we're going out to, I mean, people are even going out east of the mountains right now. Clealum and different areas.
I won't be going out there.
Yeah.
No. For my second home purchase,
exactly.
I'd love to, yes.
Exactly. I was up in Kingston the other day, and literally there were three offers on a Kingston house after two days on the market.
Oh,
no.
My gosh.
And so it is, Kitsap County is a huge area right now where people are jumping over to, but we are going to have to counsel some of our people if they can move out a little bit farther
of course.
To get their money.
Well, when the whole transit thing improves, I've had representation come into studio on that. It's exciting what's coming up, but we're looking like into 2030 before we get, but that'll be exciting. So do you think in that, Lori, that's a lot of second home buyers going out there? Are you really, people are buying their primary residence?
No,
in
there
community?
Really are people that are
really?
Buying. Sometimes, like for instance, my client that
you
was
take
up
the train.
In Kingston, you certainly can.
I would love that.
Kingston, you just take the ferry over and take the train down.
Okay.
And he's a professor at the Seattle University, and so he only has to work a couple days a week. So it was something that we could do to try to not compete as much, and then of course we get into multiple offers even up there.
Katie?
Yeah, we're seeing a lot of people coming down from Seattle into Pierce County buying new construction, but again, I agree with Jeff, those prices are pretty high.
Yeah.
But they're widening 167, that commute. Yeah. They're trying to make it easier because we do have so many commuters going to these commuter cities, Puyallup and Sumner and Ording, and so it's getting real congested, but there's the link, the train, and we're trying to figure out better options for people coming up north.
Well, and I was in Tacoma not too long ago, and it's been a while since I've been down in Tacoma. I grew up in Federal Way, and I was going down to the Tacoma train station, and I was, it's so beautiful there.
There is a lot of
change that's happened.
Yeah, and you know, I don't know if anyone noticed, the Tacoma News Tribune put out an article about Tacoma. Tacoma is on the top 10 list for hot real estate markets nationally.
Really?
So
mm-hmm.
Tacoma is a great place to be right now.
Tacoma's very big also, Tina, with investors right now. A lot of it has to do with the combination between the Port of Seattle and the Port of Tacoma. There's a consortium there type of a thing that they've worked on to be a really strong port. And that's, I think, going to bring thousands of new jobs into the Tacoma area.
Exciting.
So we've got some investors looking in Tacoma.
Nice. All right, you guys. Well, coming up next on the Money Hour, we're going to stay right here with the panel of real estate experts talking about today's real estate market, some of the challenges that our consumers are dealing with, and really challenges that the sellers are as well because of the lack of inventory. Lori Way with Coldwell Banker Bay, and Jennifer Nielsen with Real Living Northwest. Jeff Dickinson with, Jeff, I keep wanting to call you Jen as well. Jeff Dickinson with Remax on the Lake, and Katie Frazier with Trident Realty Group Northwest, right here at 1150 AM KKNW after the short break.
Are you looking to move to the East Side? If you're ready to plant roots in one of the many fantastic East Side communities, then it's time to talk with Jennifer Nilsson with Real Living Northwest Realtors. Jennifer Nilsson knows the East Side real estate market inside and out and has spent the last 12 years helping buyers locate the right East Side house for them. Jennifer specializes in relocation and buyer representation in Kirkland, Bellevue, Redmond, and Bothell. She makes the moving process stress-free and fun. Jennifer Nilsson with Real Living Northwest Realtors has helped hundreds of families buy homes in Kirkland, Bellevue, Redmond, and Bothell since 2002. And she would love to help you make the jump to East Side living.
Hi, this is Jennifer Nilsson with Real Living Northwest Realtors. To request a free relocation packet and East Side real estate guide, please visit www.livekirklandwa.com or call me directly to set up a free, no obligation new client consultation at 206-853-1491. That's 206-853-1491. I look forward to helping you find the perfect East Side home this year.
You're listening to The Money Hour with your host, Tina Mitchell. Sponsored by Absolute Mortgage, a division of Pinnacle Capital Mortgage Corporation. Now, in the studio, local mortgage and finance expert, Tina Mitchell.
Welcome back to The Money Hour with your host and mortgage expert, Tina Mitchell, right here on 1150 AM KKNW, this Saturday, January 16th show. I've built a network of elite industry professionals every week, sharing their knowledge and expertise to my listeners. If you're hearing my show at a different time your day, you're listening to rebroadcast, to talk with the guest I have in studio, or anything you want to share, suggestions on topics bringing into future shows, please let me know, 1-855-400-1150. Again, that's 1-855-400-1150 or online at themoneyhour.com. In studio now, continue my conversation with my panel. If you're a buyer or seller in today's real estate market, today's show is all about you. A panel conversation about real estate in our local market with our local experts. Lori Way with Coulter Banker Bain, Jennifer Nielsen with Real Living Northwest, Jeff Dickinson with REMAX on the Lake, and Katie Frazier with Trident Realty Group Northwest. Well, you guys, we were kind of having a conversation about what happened last year, what might be coming up for 2016. We've talked about the lack of inventory, what might happen with new construction. And I want to kind of shift over to the rental market, because I don't know. I just try to think back. I've been doing mortgages since May of 1995, and I don't know that I've ever remember being in a market to where there's a challenge on both sides. And that's, I mean, we've definitely, everybody who's probably know that we've seen challenges in the rental market last year. What's going to happen this year?
Well, I think the rental market's even more brutal than the real estate market.
Certainly, absolutely.
Yeah, those multiple offers are coming in on rental market. What is it, Jennifer or Jen? What do you think?
Yeah, there's actually a NAR statistic that we have 2.5 million fewer homeowners than we did in 2006 nationally in the U.S. And so, what happened with all those people? They're renting. They're not moving home with mom and dad.
Exactly.
And you know, I am seeing very, very qualified renters having to put in applications on 5, 6, 7 different places.
Have we ever seen that before?
I don't remember.
I do remember a few years ago when it seemed like you had to dress up in a suit and tie and have a resume in order to go try to get a rental. And I think we're back into that again.
You've got to really present yourself. And
it's like a job interview.
Yeah. It's crazy. Do you guys see that getting better? What are your thoughts?
I think maybe later this year or next year, as more rental inventory comes online, there will be a supply-demand balance there somewhere.
Yeah, and I think there has to be a burn. I know that there is, but the question is how much? There's got to be a percentage of those that just don't know that they get actually in a position to buy. But then what do we do if they come into the market and we don't have inventory anyway? So no matter how we look at it, it's just a challenge is there. So for adapting to the market for 2016, what are some things that buyers need to do coming into the market if they want to be successful? What are some tips that you have, Katie?
Yeah, well, I think buyers need to be fully approved and underwritten and be ready to go in with a strong offer. And be ready to move very quickly yes. and aggressively.
So these casual conversations and getting a pre-qualification is not the way to go. Jen?
Yeah, I think in terms of adaptation, buyers, and they're probably not going to love to hear this, but I think they are just going to have to bring their A game and make the strongest offers possible and just realize that if they want to become a homeowner, it may mean staying in the home an extra, 5-10 years, making that a more of a long-term investment. Mm-hmm.
What are some other tips for buyers right now to really be able to negotiate and present a competitive offer? Jeff?
I think I'm still not seeing very many buyers using personal letters to sellers. Mm. I'm winning
really?
Offers left and right with those.
Uh-huh.
And so it's, I think it's a great strategy to
still being able to stay connected emotionally with the seller, as long
absolutely.
As they're not mentioning anything about their race and religion and
right,
being
sure.
Cautious
right.
in that arena. Lori?
Exactly what you just said, Tina.
Uh-huh.
But also last night I helped an agent who was in a multiple offer situation, and the buyers happened to find out that the sellers had a Newfoundland, and they had a Newfoundland. And so they actually weren't the highest, but they got the offer.
Yeah.
Because
and,
of
it's,
it.
And it's really, it's all those things. And I heard, too, a tip that an agent had mentioned was offering the seller to just leave all of their garbage and all of their stuff behind. Mm-hmm. I mean, just like really laying it out and mm-hmm. making it as easy as possible so that they don't have to, those little things that you really don't know unless you just put it out there, put everything, all your cards out to be convenient for the seller.
And
anything
else? Find out what the seller is doing. Like, what do they have to close, and then give them a few days extra closing so that they can close on their house. That will help a lot because, as I said before, we've got a lot of people out there that don't know what they're going to do once they sell their house. So if you can free them up for that, or rent back, let them rent
yeah.
back or something.
And that's
like
a good
that.
Point, Lori. Is really, I mean, understanding, and that's for your why I have talked on the show how important it is not just to have an expert. Expert is really that 20% that's doing 80% of the business, and then you have your 1%ers out there that are just, and that's why I have you guys in studio, because you guys are all just very successful in your real estate practices. But it's so important to have that expertise, because there are so many things that can go wrong. I want to actually shift over to that for a second. And what would you see in for a real estate agent representing a buyer, and something that they can that they've done that actually is putting that offer at risk of not getting accepted? So where are the mistakes being made with the agents that don't have as much experience?
Well, Lori? In talking about, we haven't brought up the escalation clauses yet, so
let's
we might
bring
as
that,
well
let's bring that up. Let's talk about it.
Nasty
explain what that is, Lori, for my listeners that don't know.
So an escalator clause is used especially in multiple offers, where if the house is, say, $400,000, you say, we'll offer you $400,000, but we'll offer you $4,000 more than the highest offer up to whatever price you want it to be.
Yes.
They're very popular in the city. I used an escalator in Kingston, so mm-hmm. I mean, it's moving out. And so what ends up happening is that the agents have to sit down and figure out what the escalator has escalated up to. And usually that's the winner, not always. It's not always money, but usually that's the winner of the home. And so I have to have a really serious talk with my buyers to say, listen, you guys, what is your walkaway number?
Yes.
What are you not going to feel bad that somebody else got that house? Because
I love that.
So that's the biggest mistake they make. They escalate maybe 15 over, and somebody gets it for 20 over, and they afterwards they go, oh my God, I would have paid that.
Yes.
I would have paid $20,000.
And having that information of just every $1,000, it's $5 a month.
Yep.
So what are you willing to lose that
exactly.
house? I love that, Jen.
That is such a good point, Lori. I have been on both sides of that.
Yes, I think we all have.
Yeah. And I was going to say, so I list more than I represent buyers.
Uh-huh.
And one of the things that I noticed that sellers respond very negatively to are contracts and offers that are too wordy. They have too many weasel clauses in them. They have too many addendums. There's a very fine line between being conservative and diligent and careful
yes.
and coming across like you're going to be a pain in the neck in this whole thing.
Makes sense.
And I think if you can just do your best to be careful and, yes. and not expose yourself too much, but come across as friendly mm-hmm. in the offer.
That's a really good point because remember, if you're listening to the show, you have a real estate expert that's representing the seller, which means they've seen everything in the industry and what can happen. And that's huge because once the contract's accepted, that's when all the work happens and that's when all the issues can come up that buyer is going to actually back out.
Right.
Correct?
Yeah, and you want to make it as friendly as possible to the seller to let them know that your buyers are very earnest in wanting to purchase a home and they're not looking for an out.
Exactly. Yep. So let's talk about how awesome it is to live here in the Northwest. Now, I mean, we just have to add in the weather on top of that now. El Nemo my tongue twist with my words here, is it's really helping us out with our beautiful weather. But then we thought our employment opportunity, it's just unbelievable. We have representation from every side of the employment. What else is happening in our market that is making us so strong and continued that If the real estate market is appreciating, our market is going to be there. The question is, I mean, at some point in time, markets have to drop. It's the history of market goes up and down. But what other benefits do we have here in our area? Lori?
Well, obviously, I grew up here, and I love it here. I never get tired of seeing Mount Rainier or going up to the mountains or getting on my boat, going out on the lake. It's just absolutely great way of life here. But I think one thing that and helped us during the whole dropout of the market is we didn't go down as low because we still have employers bringing people in. We're so lucky. We've got Amazon and Microsoft and Nordstrom and, I mean, just on Starbucks, Costco. It goes on and on and on about how successful our companies are here. The biotech industry is just
crazy.
Blowing up here.
Yes.
So we continued. We did not stay even or drop just a little bit because of people locally.
Yes.
We were bringing in people and that was helping us keep the prices up.
Yes, and that's why people from out of the country are coming in and, choosing here. Jeff? Yep.
I think only traffic is the negative. Everything else is just absolutely positive.
Yeah.
I mean,
but any other good market, they've got that, you know, dealing with traffic as well. And that's why I'm so excited with Sounds Transit. And I just want to have him back in studio again. It was interesting having him and our state representative, Judy Claiborne, talking about all of the expansion and things that are coming up, which I'm sure that you're really key on that, Katie.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I was going to add, as I do represent kind of Pierce County and down south, I work primarily with VA, military home buyers. And so the largest source of income down south isn't JBLM, Joint Base Lewis-McChord, but it's the retired military. And so we have the VA hospital, we have Madigan, and it is so affordable. And those retired military folks, they have a fixed income. And so we see a lot of retired military buying right now down there, and it's keeping things moving along for us.
Yeah, that's awesome. Anything else you guys want to share, Jen?
Yeah, I might just throw in there, too, that so my office's niche is relocation. That's what we do a lot of. And one of the statistics that's always thrown out to us is that Washington is in the top three states for relocation and bringing people in, followed by California and Texas. And I think, you know, I get to spend a lot of time in the cars with these people coming in from out of state. And one of the things that I am constantly amazed at is that the ones who have families and the ones who have really done their research tell me that our education here from elementary school all the way up to the collegiate level is great.
Really?
And everybody,
it's
all about the schools here. And it's not unusual for people to come in hand with the schools they've already researched.
So great schools, great employment, beautiful area. You can get anything you want from the water to the mountain. And, you know, I like it that we can just hop over not too far and we can get anything that we want as far as the variety and the different seasons. Mm-hmm. So great conversation. I'm just enjoying this so much. And I know my listeners have to be as well. And we're going to stay here with the panel, but I got to take us to break. Coming up next on the Money Hour, continued conversation with our power players in real estate, having a power conversation on everything in our local market. Lori Way with Coldwell Banker Bain, Jennifer Nielsen with Real Living Northwest, Jeff Dickinson with REMAX on the Lake, and Katie Frazier with Trident Realty Group Northwest, right here at 1150 AM KKNW after the short break.
You're listening to The Money Hour with your host, Tina Mitchell. sponsored by Absolute Mortgage, a division of Pinnacle Capital Mortgage Corporation. Now, in the studio, local mortgage and finance expert, Tina Mitchell.
Welcome back to the Money Hour with your host and mortgage expert, Tina Mitchell, right here at 1150 AM KKNW, the Saturday, January 16th show. I'm empowering our community, providing you with opportunities and solutions when it comes to your money. If you're hearing my show at a different time or day, you are listening to a rebroadcast. You can call the show at 1-855-400-1150 or online at themoneyhour.com to discuss anything regarding your finances, anything regarding money. That's what the show is all about. And if you'd like to talk with the guests that I have in studio today, show is all about real estate. Experts in the real estate arena here to share a wealth of information in our local market. Again, I have Lori Way with Coldwell Banker Bain, Jennifer Nielsen with Real Living Northwest, Jeff Dickinson with REMAX on the Lake, and Katie Frazier with Trident Realty Group Northwest. And we've had a great conversation, you guys, the first couple segments here about what's happening in the local real estate market, what happened last year, what's happening this year, the great reasons to want to live in Seattle. And I want to talk about anything that you can think of that might hinder things coming up in 2016. Lori?
I think one thing that is going to hinder as far as especially sellers and then this whole low inventory thing is the whole thing that we were talking about before. I think a lot of sellers are going to have to come up with a plan of maybe temporary housing. I mean, if they want to move up and get a bigger place or if they're wanting to move down, looking into some, temporary housing kind of things to be able to get their money and then go out and really compete.
Yes.
Otherwise, you're juggling balls and it can get scary for the sellers.
Are you guys seeing a lot of your sales or a percentage of them that are holding on to their property, buying their new one, and then waiting to sell?
If you're lucky enough.
If they can.
But lucky enough because of the financing side of it.
Right.
Yeah. Jen?
Yeah, actually, my parents tried to do that. They're up in Camino Island, and we're actually working with a different agent, but for geographical reasons. But they tried doing that for a long time, and they couldn't swing it. They couldn't find a property to purchase here, so they did end up selling and then moving to where they wanted to be and renting and doing like a temporary furnished thing, exactly like you said, Lori.
Yeah.
And so, if you have pets or anything like that, it's even more difficult because you can't find places that you can keep your dogs and that type of thing, too. I have some clients that they want to be in the city, but they had to be over in Bellevue because they couldn't find a place for their dog that they could rent until they could move in.
Yeah. So staying on the seller side of this, for my sellers that are listening to the show, what other challenges do they have when they're looking at selling their property, or maybe something that they're not realistic about, or what are you seeing out there and advice that you have for my sellers? Jeff?
Well, I would like to see sellers do more pre-listing home inspections, just to eliminate
that. So talk about
that,
Jeff, and what that means and entails for the seller.
The idea is really for an enterprising seller to have a full-blown home inspection done prior to coming on the market, and that allows the seller to fix some items and be aware of some items that would be a concern, and you're literally eliminating the second round of negotiations.
Which is huge, because if you think about this, just think, if you're a seller right now, just put your thinking cap on and imagine you've got a signed contract. The contract's all signed and ready to go. And then you get through the contract. The inspection comes back from the buyer. Now, your house has been taken off the market. You're already starting to move. You're emotionally attached to that sell closing. Do you think that you're going to get the best negotiation flexibility in the middle of a contract? You've completely lost control at this time. So take the control, get the inspection done in the beginning. Great advice. Katie, what do you have for our sellers?
I mean, you can never get a second chance at a first impression, right?
Great point.
So I would say take care of any deferred maintenance issues, have it ready to go, and again, have the pre-inspection set.
Yes. Jen?
You know, and I would say, too, I happen to work in an area where there is a decent amount of new construction. This is in the Bothell kind of North Creek area. And I've had a couple of sellers who had resale homes to sell this year, and they just couldn't wrap their minds around having to compete with all the new construction in the area.
Yeah.
And you are not new construction. You might have a great house in great shape, but it's really hard to compete against that. So you either need to make some updates to make your home more competitive or price it accordingly And don't be late to the game with pricing if you've got new construction.
Yes. Now, there's also a lot of different advice that's given as far as looking at offers and how to get through these, the multiple offers that you're that they're receiving, because I could imagine that could be a little overwhelming. So what is what strategies are you guys using with your sellers as far as the actual offers when you're looking at them, how you're negotiating them? Any feedback there for my sellers? Jeff?
Well, the first advice that I give to my sellers is to really seriously look at the first offer that comes in.
Uh-huh.
I had a whole rash of those last year where they got an offer the next day and it was at full price and no contingencies, and they say, well, I think we're just going to hold out for an even better one.
Yes.
I have probably four or five sellers that did that, and it probably cost them $25,000 each is what I calculated doing it.
Wow.
Because another offer didn't come in.
Yeah.
So it was just kind of strange from that standpoint.
Yeah.
But for my sellers, I put multiple offers on an Excel spreadsheet,
uh-huh,
you know, to kind of highlight those to...
So they can really see, because there's so many different factors. So you've, you know, kind of weigh out and see what makes the most sense. And I know I'm in the financing arena, and I know the nightmares that happens out there. I mean, I see things happen all the time, not with my loans, of course. But it's they say statistics say 30% of mortgages fall apart. And so I know, and again, that's something that's important for a buyer to understand, that it's not really, you're not just talking, well, you're not talking directly to the seller at all, but it's not the seller that's really... is they're making that decision, but they have hired an expert to help them get through that process. Jen?
Yeah, I was just going to say, you know, this is a tip for any buyer out there right now. Just do yourself a favor and work with a professional, full-service broker.
Uh-huh.
This is their only job. This is what they do and what they know. I can't tell you in how many instances when I've had a multiple offer situation and a seller's looked at me and said, you know, I don't know. These are all so close. And what do you think? What do you think?
Uh-huh.
And quite frankly, you know, the agent makes an impression on me. And I think that if I get a good feeling from an agent, I feel like it's an indication of things to come and what's going to happen with that buyer. And, you know, I try to let them make their own decision. But if my seller is looking at me, I'm going to say, well, I had a good experience with this agent, or they made a good impression on me, and this is what they
Which
indicated.
I imagine they're
and
always
I,
looking at you. You're highly recommended. You know, you've got a close relationship with your clients, and so that's why they've hired you.
Well, right. And I just think buyers can do themselves a favor by hiring a real professional in the area.
So let's talk about that, because, and again, I just bringing in that the they've hired an expert to help them through the process. How much is your reputation in your local market going to make or break when you're off, when you're representing a buyer and that other agent that's representing the seller, if you don't have a great reputation in the industry? I mean, that's a big deal.
I think it is I think it is a big deal, and I think that, I mean, I certainly have agents that I'd prefer to work with.
Uh-huh.
There's no doubt about it. And I think also one thing that Jen brought up as far as working with a professional, I think that's also true in the lending area of it too. I think, you know, if you look at somebody and you've never heard of them before, you don't know if they're going to be able to close on time, because closing on time is up to the lender. That's really it. They're the boss. So I think you really need to get a good, strong lender that you know is going to be able to close on time and with the least amount of problems.
Yeah, definitely. In all areas, you've want to definitely be working with the best to have a good experience. Let's talk about open houses with sellers. Are you guys doing those? Is it a good idea? Lori?
I do open houses. I love open houses.
Okay. And what is the benefit that provides for your seller?
Well, obviously, you want to expose any property all the ways you can.
Yes.
From a sign to, you know, at web advertising, social network. I mean, there's just, you never know where that buyer is going to come from.
Uh-huh.
And open houses, I mean, it doesn't happen a lot where somebody walks in and says, oh, yes, I'm going to get this.
Yes.
But it does happen, so you have to...
You have to do exposure.
Yeah,
and I think
that's
a mistake that sellers can make, is just thinking because it's such a great offer. It's not a question if you're going to be able to sell your home. The question is how much property you're going to walk away with.
Right.
So, Lori, what about photography and how the home shows? How much of a difference does that make in the price they're going to get?
Well, it makes a lot of difference, and I think your listeners are going to be able to know this. They've probably been looking at things online, and you can tell when it's been mm-hmm. taken by an iPhone, by an agent, and their reflection happens to be in the mirror while uh-huh. they're taking a picture of the bathroom.
Not a good look.
It's absolutely critical to have professional photography now
yes.
in the fact that I would say more than 9 out of 10 people see their house online first before they actually go out and look at it.
Yeah.
So photography is critical. The other thing that's critical, it's not new, but it's newer, is staging.
Yes.
It's just almost mandatory. Mm-hmm. And that would be another mistake a seller could make, is to try to save money. But you do, I think everybody would agree here, yeah. you make so much more money. You're on the market less time. It's great.
Yes. Yep. And it is. It's connecting that with the emotional yep. connection with the buyer. Jeff?
Yep. Yeah. Going back to the professional photography, it amazes me that 9 out of 10 listings do not use professional photography.
Really?
It's just amazing, which is great for those. Yeah.
For those that do.
Few
yeah.
of us that do. It really
stands out. Because they just slap the pictures up on the MLS and everything's good. Mm-hmm. And again, it's not about as much of selling the home, but it's, do you want to make as much profit as you can? Katie?
Yeah. And, you know, to piggyback on that, working with mostly buyers in the age of social media
yes.
and Facebook and Instagram, everyone has access to these great filters, and it's all about a picture right now.
Yes.
And so a lot of my new buyers, first-time home buyers, they have their own technology for their own photos. And so when they're looking at homes and they're not beautifully represented,
yes.
they want to just go on to the next and don't want to take the time. So absolutely, it's all in presentation. Getting a drone,
yep.
and there's 3D photography. There's so many advances in that.
Yeah, it makes total sense. Any other tips that you got, Jen?
Oh, I was just going to say, I think the 3D
yeah.
tour is
yes.
is
yeah,
the next big wave.
Cool.
Because very
cool.
Do you know, we actually had, I mentioned that we do a lot of relocation. Mm-hmm. And, you know, these people are going to be here for 3 to 5 years. And we actually had a client buy a home sight unseen based on
yes.
the video tour. And that's rare,
uh-huh.
but that was a big deal. And being that Seattle's so transient, we have so mm-hmm. many contractors here, and they're just saying, let me get into the location and the school I want, and then, I can live in the house for the next 3 years. Having that is a big deal.
It is.
It will probably be a big deal for you, too, with the VA.
It's a huge deal, because a lot of the buyers that I represent are PCSing over
yes.
from other states. Even I had a gal who just closed in her home from Germany, and so
yeah.
I'm going through the home with my phone, taking videos.
Wow.
I had a friend suggest having my kids run through the home with a GoPro. but the 3D technology is so fantastic. So, yeah, I'd like to see more of it.
Yeah.
I'm doing 3D on all my listings now. It's just another thing
yep.
like staging and
yeah.
professional photography. You just got to do it.
You got to
yeah.
be able to show the house at its best on an online view of it. So my listeners love stories. The show is almost at the end of the hour here, but I would love to hear a success story from any of you, or if you have a story of something that did not go so successful and a solution for that. Who wants to share a story with my listeners? Lori?
Yeah. So a success story is, and I do this just as maybe a learning for your listeners,
okay.
is we had some people that just really wanted to be in North Seattle. Absolutely, we were getting beat out on every single offer. And so we couldn't go up in price, so we went out a little bit more. They're under contract now.
Uh-huh.
They went up to the Edmonds area, a little bit north of Edmonds. And so it's going to add maybe 15 minutes more on their time commuting, but they're in the home that they love and they want, and they want to raise their two little boys in.
And so the shout out for that and them being successful was hanging on
and yeah. and looking at other options. Can
yes.
you do 1.5 baths instead of 2 full baths?
Yes.
You know, there's a lot of options out there that you can let loose on a little bit to get the home that you really want.
Makes total sense. Anybody else on my panel have a story?
I don't have
Jen.
A story, but I guess this can sort of apply to all buyers, but
uh-huh.
I really think that the key to success right now is mentally preparing yourself for the long haul.
Yes.
It is so highly unlikely that you're going to put an offer on the first home you see and you're going to get it.
Yes.
I mean, I'm having clients who are putting 3 or 4 offers in on properties and it's maybe 5 or 6 until one sticks,
yes.
you know? And I think the other key is quick decision making. You can't waffle because someone's
great
else
advice.
Is going to beat you to the punch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got to be ready. And it seems like when offers don't come through, it always seems like majority of the time it wasn't the right house and they were glad that offer didn't come through.
Yeah.
Anyways, 60 seconds, one more shout out for my listeners, you guys. Anything that you want to end the show with?
Well, I would also say from what Jen's saying is that you can't wait till Saturday to go and look at the house.
Yeah, you have urgency.
That's what I meant to say.
Yeah. So you guys have heard it. Be realistic. Just keep fighting the fight and have a sense of urgency. You guys, thank you so much. What a pleasure.
Thank
it was
you.
Just a really
thank
great
you,
hour. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
And this is your host and mortgage expert, Tina Mitchell, signing off for the day. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. I will be here same time, same place, different guest in studio, but we're going to be talking money right here on 1150 AM KKNW. Thanks.